Hi there, and welcome to The Works. I'm Ben Che. Later in the show, guitarist Ron N, a familiar face to many interested in Hong Kong's jazz scene, will be joining us with the other members of his trio to talk about music and all that jazz. Traditional Japanese puppetry dates back to ancient times when it was often part of shamanic religious services. By the 17th century, during the Edo period, three main forms of puppet performance had developed, and the art had become highly popular. Last month, a century-old Japanese puppetry troupe came to Hong Kong for the first time to introduce their artistry.
Edo にも東京にも三人使いという人形芝居が盛んに興行をしていました。で、ところが今から170年ぐらい前に、実はその三人使い、江戸の三人使いはいろんな文化が東京に入ってきたのでなくなってしまいます。そこで初代の西川Koryuが、その人形を残すために三人使いの人形を一人使いにしたのがこの車人形ということになるんですね。
The form of performance known as Ninyon Joruri is said to have been developed around 1590 to 1600 by puppeteers from the inland island of Awaji. Ninyon means puppet. The phrase Joruri refers to a form of storytelling accompanied by a chanted narration and the plucked instrument, the shamisen. Puppeteer Uemura Bunrakuken, who was originally from Awaji, opened a training center for Ninyon Joruri in Osaka in the 1790s. He went on in 1805 to form a small troupe that developed into the Bunrakuza. The troupe played a major role in keeping Ninyon Joruri alive. Hence, the art is now commonly referred to as Bunraku. At one time, individual puppets were controlled by three people. In the mid-19th century, partly for economic reasons, a new single puppeteer technique, Kuruma Ninyo, puppets on wheels or cart puppetry, was developed. Today in Japan, just three Kuruma Ninyo troupes remain. One is the Koryu Nishikawa troupe from Hachioji, a suburb in western Tokyo.
いろんなものをチャレンジしましたけども、実は4代目はすごく買ったもんですから、実はその昔にある形を一切、実は、形をすべて変えて、足も手も人形の顔もきちっと修理をし直して、衣装も新しくして、そして新しい技術をどんどん先代は取り入れたんですけども、まあ、僕の場合ですと、もうちょっとそこを先を進んで、まあ、先代と一緒には考えたんですけども、他の技術も取り入れて、その外国の踊りもできるようなもの。
Koryu Nishikawa V is a fifth generation master of Hachioji puppetry. His birth name is Toru Senuma. He learned the art from his father when he was 12 years old. He also studied the three-person puppetry of Bunraku at the National Bunraku Theater, as well as studying directing and performance overseas. He says his father began by teaching him how to operate the three-wheel cart before he could work with the puppets.
足のかかとにちょっとこうフックがついてます。ですからこれを人形使いが足の指で挟んで自分の足を使って人形の足を動かします。この車人形の特徴はこの足にあります。舞台の上を足を踏むことができる。音も鳴らすことができる。右手はそのままこういうふうに三人使いさんと同じですけどもこう手首をこうやって動かすことができて自分でこう使いながら動かすことができる。で左手は実はこう長くなってます。ここにバネがついておりちょっとこう弓矢を引くみたいなような格好にこうなりますけどもう一つここにちょっと出っ張りがあります。親指でこれをこう上げてこの手をこう動かしていくと両方の手が動くということになります。実はこの人形の顔と左手は一緒に持ちます。で人形の顔を動かしながら左手も使っていく。そして右手も使っていく。で、車に座ることによって人形の足も使っていく。ということで、一人で一体の人形を動かせるのがこの車人形の特徴ということになるわけです。
The Koryu Nishikawa troupe was established 170 years ago. Today it has 15 members, all of whom have to take a stage name and adopt Nishikawa as their surname. In its fourth generation, the troupe began to take female members. Ryosuzu Nishikawa has 20 years of experience.
劇団に入るきっかけとなったのは、先ほどインタビューで家元もおっしゃっていた育成のための講座というものに入会させていただきまして、で、そこで当初は1ヶ月ぐらいの講習だったんですけれども、まあ、そこに興味を持ったというところで、その後、劇団の方に通わせていただいて、正式に座員として認めていただいたという流れですね。
In June, the company made its debut in Hong Kong, staging three performances to showcase the repertoire. The opening performance, Sanbaso, is a joyful dance based on okina from Noh Theatre. It is performed as a ritual at the beginning of traditional performances to purify the stage. The troupe also performed two comedies. One is Zuri Ona, meaning fishing woman. The other, excerpts of Yaji-san and Kita-san, is based on a comedic novel by Jupensha Iku. It's a combination of comedy and horror, a classic example of Edo period puppetry.
<音楽>日本のその浄瑠璃っていうのは、8割以上が悲劇の芝居なんですね、全てのものが。で、そんな中で、そのコメディ的なものと、そのその舞踊的なものっていうのに分かれるんです。特に浄瑠璃っていうのは、太夫さんは一人で何人もの声を出して、 それが 10人いようと 20人いようときっと声を変えて、その雰囲気を作っていく。ですから、その他に三味線弾きっていうのは、情景描写、心理描写っていうのを音楽としてこう表現をしていく。ですから、お互いに持てる力を 100% 出して、人形が喋らないで我々は人形を使うことで、その中で集中をして使うっていう。 人形っていうのは先代から言われるように、その人形を動かすっていうのはたやすいんですね。そうです。で、動かすっていうのは本当にもう2週間もあれば人形は動きます。しかし、人形を使うっていうことに関しては我々は一生の勉強だと思ってるので、で、通常で言うと舞台は5、6年で舞台にも上がって人形のお芝居の中の中心ではないんですけども、いろんな役を こなしながらやっていきます。どこが一人前になるかっていうと、まあそれは10年を見込んでますけども、でもそこでもまだ中途半端なので、やっぱり我々っていうのは最終的にはそのゴールっていうものがありませんから、死んだ時がゴールかなと思ってます。
Artists Christian Schwarzwald and Kurt Chan have a common interest in words, and that interest is featured in a current exhibition to paint the written world at Hanart TZ Gallery. For Schwarzwald, the writing of words is an act of drawing and a gestural practice. Chan takes a more abstract approach, concentrating on Chinese ideographs. The exhibition features not only their individual works, but also a painting created on site that involves a collaboration of the two artists and the public. Welcome back. With an academic background in music composition, Ron Ng plays the guitar. A versatile musician, he performs with different groups and in different styles, including jazz, blues, rock, funk, classical, and contemporary music. But jazz is closest to his heart. He teaches jazz ensemble improvisation at the Hong Kong Academy for Performing Arts, and he's here with the other members of his trio to tell us more. So, Edwin, Jimmy, Ron, welcome to The Works.
Thank you. Okay.
So you are the Ron Ng trio. Let's start by talking about this. I'm going to ask you a question. In jazz, many times you have the freedom to improvise within a song, within the music. Would you say that there is also the freedom to choose who you play with, whether it's a trio, a quartet, or a quintet?
I would say there's definitely that freedom. And depending on the circumstances, depending on the venue, depending on whether you're playing for a client or you're just performing at a bar, you may choose a different format, or you may simply want to try a different format and explore maybe some repertoire of those trios or quartets that you really admire from the past. So it's all depending on the circumstance. Right. And most jazz musicians have a lot of experience playing in many different types of formats.
Well, tell me a bit about this particular trio. You know, what was the inspiration, or what was it that got you three together in the first place?
I met Jimmy 10 years ago in a very famous jazz bar called Pufesco, and we played a quartet gig. And after that, we formed a band and always played together. Yes, and Edwin, he's one of my audience in my jazz show. Then after that, we always jam together and become a close fan. And in this trio, I want to play some beatbox music. And I want the music to have more energy, so I have to jump in this trio. Mm. Mm.
Well, I'm going to focus on you again, Ron. So you, as a former student of the APA, you're now a lecturer there, and you teach jazz improvisation. Tell me a bit about this course and what it's about.
Oh, sure. It's a jazz ensemble class. I'm the lecturer in this class. And they all are very good classical musicians. And they have an excellent technique and have a very good musical sense, I think. And I have to teach them how to read the score, how to carry the rhythm, and which scale they should use. And we have concert in HKAPA every year too. Yes.
Right. Well, speaking of sort of teaching them how to improvise, then I want to ask the others, you know, when it comes to improvisation, how do you approach it? So, Edwin, as a drummer, you know, how does it work for you?
I think it's most time is listen to each other, because the jazz tone is every time is different. Yeah. So, I think the mindset is the important is the always open. Yeah, to listen the different musician, even the same song. Different musicians play also have the different tone.
Right. Yeah. And maybe on the double bass, is that the same concept?
Yeah, I think the most important thing that Edwin said there, which is great, is listen. And it's all about listening. Jazz is an oral art form, which means that it's primarily about listening to the music and learning it through that way, rather than learning it from a score like classical music. So first and foremost, it's about listening to all the records and listening to the greats and just trying to imitate that at first. And as you start to imitate it, then you can internalize it more. And then later, when you have the requisite skill, you can create your own sort of improvisation once you've imitated to a certain extent and really internalized the music. Then suddenly you can apply the technique you may have learned in classical studies or otherwise, and then, as they say, forget about all that and just play.
Right. Very cool. Well, I want to ask you about the development of jazz in recent years. How would you describe maybe the local scene? Are a lot of young people interested, or do you feel that more younger musicians who are taking up jazz and going into it?
Yes, I think it's more younger musician play jazz now, because of maybe YouTube and the internet, they have more method to find the material, and they can self-learning. So I think more younger musician play jazz now.
And do you think that it's the wider audience, is there more of an appreciation for jazz in Hong Kong than there was in the past?
I think that particularly after COVID, there has been an appreciation of live music in general that has been unprecedented, I think, in recent years. And so that has been great, not only for jazz, but for all types of music. But that being said, when I do play jazz gigs, I see a lot of people who are quite interested in it, and they may not know a lot about jazz, but when they see it live, they do appreciate it.
Well, finally, we'd love to hear a song since all three of you are here. I believe you've prepared a piece by Chick Corea. Maybe tell me the name of the song and why you've chosen this piece and how you've managed to rearrange it for the guitar trio.
So the name of the song is Armando's Rumba, and it's a very famous tune by the incredible jazz pianist Chick Corea. And the original version of the song features a violin and of course piano playing the melody. And for this particular tune, it's unique in that the melody is played in unison, or in other words, everyone in the band is playing the melody or the tune. So with that in mind, the arrangement kind of worked out itself in a sense, in that though we have different instruments than the original recording, we're all playing that unison melody in the same way. And then in terms of the specifics, the nitty-gritty of the form and everything, we kind of had a little bit of a chat briefly before the gig and then decided, okay, let's go for it. Let's do it this way. Let's consider how much time we have for the performance, and we'll arrange it in this way. And aside from that, then we just go.
Very cool. Well, I look forward to hearing it. Thank you all of you for coming in, and let's hear it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.